The life of Christ is the greatest story ever told. We need to know who Jesus is, what he taught, how he lived, and what he promised. In this fourth lesson, we shall look at the study of the life and ministry of Christ. To begin this study, let us look at the four Gospels which have been written about the life and ministry of Jesus and attempt to answer the question of why the four different accounts of the same thing. Matthew, Mark, and Luke are usually referred to as the synoptic Gospels. The word synoptic comes from the Greek word that means to see together, or literally able to be seen together. It is because each of these three gospel writers give an account of the same events in Jesus' life. It is very possible to set them down in parallel columns and compare them one with the other and see that their arrangement is the same. The Gospel of John has a different account of the scene of Jesus' ministry. He did not write his gospel as a historical account, but a spiritual gospel. He presented Jesus as the mind of God in a person come to earth and as one who possesses reality instead of shadows and able to lead men out of the shadows into the real world. Each of the four gospel writers was telling the story of Jesus to a particular group of readers, and each writer had his own special way of telling the story so that his readers would best understand the good news about Jesus Christ. Let us critically look at each gospel for the main purpose for which it was written. There is very little known about Matthew. We read that he was a tax collector who was called by Jesus and left everything behind to follow Jesus. He must have been a bitterly hated man, for the Jews hated the members of their own race who had entered the civil service of their oppressors. Matthew had one gift that all other apostles did not have. He was an expert in putting words together on paper, since his work as tax collector involved record keeping. Matthew's interest as he wrote his gospel was in the Jews. His Jewishness is seen in his attitude to the law. Jesus did not come to destroy the law, but to fulfill it. The righteousness of the Christian must exceed the righteousness of the Pharisees and the scribes. Matthew was written by one who knew and loved the law, and who saw that even the law has its place in the Christian economy. Matthew begins his writing with a genealogy that is to prove that Jesus is the son of David. His picture of Jesus is of the man born to be king. Jesus walks through his pages in royalty. He writes to demonstrate the royalty of Jesus. Matthew is primarily the teaching gospel. He arranges his stories in such a way that is easy to remember and memorize. His gospel can be divided into five sections, all of which are dealing with the kingdom of God: the Sermon on the Mountain, or the laws of the kingdom, chapter 5, 6, and 7, the duties of the leaders of the kingdom, chapter 10, the parables of the kingdom, chapter 13, greatness and forgiveness in the kingdom, chapter 18, the coming of the king of the kingdom, chapter 24 and 25. When the Gospels are examined carefully, There is every reason to believe that Mark must have been the first of the Gospels to be written. The two, Matthew and Luke, are using Mark as a basis. Mark gave a simple, vivid, and direct narrative. In Mark, Christ is depicted as the servant of God, as one who, though is equal with God, made himself of no reputation and took upon himself the form of a servant. Everything in Mark's gospel contributes to this central theme. This is why there are more miracles, which are deeds of service, in the gospel of Mark than in any other gospel. Mark gave very delightful facts of Jesus' life in the simplest and most dramatic way. This is the nearest thing we will ever get to a report of Jesus' life, just picturing him as he was. Luke was a Gentile who was a medical doctor by profession. He is the only New Testament writer who was not a Jew. He wrote his gospel to a man called Theophilus. Since he called him most excellent, we believe that he must have been a high official in the Roman government. He wrote mainly for the Gentile readers. They could easily understand the story of Jesus from Luke's perspective. And because of this, Luke is the easiest of all gospels to read. He was writing not for Jews, but for people very much like ourselves. Luke saw in Jesus the sacrifice for all the world. He is the savior of the world. In Jesus, the barriers are broken down. Jesus is for Jews and Gentiles, saints and sinners alike. Many Christians see the Gospel of John as the most precious book in the New Testament. It is a book which refreshes the mind and nourishes the heart and gives rest to their souls. This is the Gospel which has no record of the birth of Jesus, no record of his baptism, his temptation, and it tells us nothing of the Last Supper. It does not even record the Gethsemane encounter and the Ascension. It has no word of healing any people possessed by evil spirits, and perhaps the most surprising of all, it has none of the parable stories which Jesus told his audience. John is interested in presenting Jesus as the mind of God in a person come to earth. He possesses reality and is able to lead people out of the shadows into the real world. His purpose was to confront the rise of heresy, which now bogged the church 70 years since Jesus had been crucified. Heresy is not only a complete untruth, but it is also overemphasizing one phase of truth unduly. John tries to stress more than any other gospel the omniscience of Jesus. He saw Jesus as one who had a special and miraculous knowledge independent of anything which any man might tell him. He needed to ask no question because he knew all the answers. He is God in the human body. To meet the Gnostics who denied Jesus' divine nature and had strange beliefs about him, John presents us with a Jesus who was undeniably human and who yet was undeniably divine. He does not give us a newspaper report of Jesus' activities, but he gives us what Jesus meant. It was the gospel written by the Holy Spirit through John. Let us see how each of these gospel writers saw Jesus as a summary of this introduction to Jesus' life and ministry. Matthew sees Jesus as a prophesied king, this key word is fulfilled and records the ancestry of Jesus from Abraham and David. And his plan of writing is a sermon. Key verse in Matthew, above his head they placed the written charge against him. This is Jesus, the King of the Jews. Chapter 27, verse 37. Mark, on the other side, sees Jesus as the obedient servant, and his key word is immediately. He records the ancestry of Jesus nowhere. Plan of his writing is action and miracles. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. Chapter 10, verse 45. Luke, on the other side, sees Jesus as a perfect man, and the key word is the Son of Man, records the ancestry of Jesus from Adam. And his plan of writing is parable and people. For the Son of Man came to seek and to save what was lost. Chapter 19, verse 10. And John, on his side, sees Jesus as the Son of God. His key word is belief, life. He records the ancestry of Jesus from God. And his plan of writing the seven wonders. The key verse in John is, but these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing, you may have life in his name. Chapter 20, verse 31. One of Jesus' top priorities was the selection and the training of his apostles. They were the inner circle of his disciples who were to preserve and to pass on his teachings. The New Testament is a record of what he taught. If we are to know Jesus and his teachings, we must turn to the New Testament to find it. We must turn to the testimony of those he himself chose and trusted to pass on his teachings. The study of the life and the ministry of Christ could be divided into seven periods. We shall look at these periods in the order of events that happened in Jesus' life, 30 years of youth. This is the period of Jesus' preparation before he begins his active ministry. The Jews accepted age 30 to be beginning period of adulthood. Events to mention in this period in Jesus' life are 1. Jesus' birth. This is recorded in the Gospels of Matthew and Luke. Matthew gave details from the father's side. He was concerned with the Jews. Luke gave details from the mother's side. It is said that both genealogies are symbolic, and that Matthew gives the royal descent of Jesus and Luke gives the priestly descent. One of the earlier suggestions was that Matthew gives the genealogy of Joseph and Luke of Mary. Two things are important to note about the genealogy of Jesus, which Luke gives. 1. It stresses the real humanity of Jesus. It stresses the fact that he was a man amongst men. To save men, he became, in the most real sense, a man. 2. Matthew stops at Abraham, but Luke goes right back to Adam. This means that to Matthew, Jesus was the possession of the Jews. To Luke, he was the possession of all mankind, because his lineage is traced back to not only the founder of the Jewish nation, but to the founder of human race. Luke removes the national and the racial boundaries even from the ancestry of Jesus. 2. Escape to Egypt. It is probable that the arrival and the departure of the Magi and the departure of Joseph for Egypt occurred in one night. If that is so, the people of Bethlehem knew nothing of these matters. The command of the angel telling Joseph to arise and take the young child and his mother and flee to Egypt was a call for immediate departure. It is important to note that Egypt was ever the refuge of Israel when fleeing from famine and oppression. The joy and the honor of the Magi's visit and worship gives place to terror at the wrath of Herod. The quiet days at Bethlehem are followed by a night of fear and flight. The parents of Jesus were experiencing those conflicting joy and sorrows which characterize the lives of all who have connected their lives with Christ. Joseph rose and took the young child and his mother by night and departed to Egypt, where they spent several years in the African soil. This was until they learned that Herod had died. 3. Return to Nazareth. This happened when Herod, who ordered the killing of all children born of Jesus' age, died, and it was now safe for Jesus' parents to come back home. This was a time of reflection of Joseph and Mary's faith in God. When Joseph came back with his family, he settled in Nazareth, a town in the northern province of Galilee. Here, Jesus grew up in obscurity till he reached his 30th year. He was faithfully performing the lesser task before the greater task was given to him to do. The greater fact is that if Jesus had failed in the smaller duties, the mighty task of being the Savior of the world could never have been given to him to do. He was faithful in little that he might become master of much. It is a thing never to be forgotten that in everyday duties of life, we make or break a destiny, and we win or lose a crown. Faithfulness is the major duty for which God has called all his children. 4. Baptism of Jesus. Jewish males had 3 stages in maturation process. First, circumcision on the 8th day. Second, at age 12 years, a child was able to visit the temple and celebrate the rituals with the grown-ups. Jesus accompanied his parents to the temple at this age, and it is this time that he disappeared from his parents' company and remained at the temple. Third, at the age of 30 years, every Jewish boy was accepted in adulthood. We can see clearly that at the age of 12 years, Jesus had already decided that he wanted to lead. The next 18 years of his life was already decided on by God. Luke chapter 2, verse 51 and 52. For 30 years, Jesus waited in Nazareth, faithfully performing the simple duties of the home and of the carpenter's shop. All the time, he knew that the world was waiting for him. He waited for the hour to strike, for the moment to come, and for the summons to sound. And when John the Baptist emerged, Jesus knew that the time had arrived. At age 30 years, Jesus was baptized. John was baptizing in the desert in the manner of the Essenes. Jesus' baptism was symbolic. Baptism is a public event representing many things. To Jesus, It was an act of obedience to God, submission. Baptism was practiced by the radicals. Those who accepted it agreed to be counted with the radicals. Jesus aligned himself with John and John's religion by accepting to be baptized by him. The voice which Jesus had at the time of baptism is of supreme importance. "This is my son in whom I'm well pleased," the voice from heaven said. So in baptism, there came to Jesus two certainties. The certainty that he was indeed the chosen one of God, and the certainty that the way in front of him was the way of the cross. In that moment, he knew he was chosen to be king, but he also knew that his throne must be a cross. In that way, he knew that he was destined to be a conqueror, but that his conquest must have as its only weapon the power of suffering love. In that moment, there was set before Jesus both his task and the only way to fulfilling of it. 5. Temptation in the wilderness. A man who has a vision must also have the immediate problem of how to turn that vision into fact. He has to find some way to turn the dream into reality. That is precisely the problem which faced Jesus. He came to lead men back to God. How was he going to do it? What method was he going to choose to work out the task which God had given him to do? Temptation is the test which comes to a man whom God wishes to use. So we must think of this whole incident not so much the tempting, but as the testing of Jesus. It helped Jesus to lay focus on his purpose. Who was he going to please? Whose agenda would he follow for his ministry? He decided that it was God's will that he will follow. This was very symbolic to the Jewish society. The first temptation was to turn stones into bread. This is the last of the flesh, hunger. The enemy's first attack was an attempt to win him by appealing to necessity of his physical nature. The tempter said to Jesus, "If you want people to follow you, use your wonderful power to give them material things." He was suggesting that Jesus should bribe people into following him. He was utterly unsuccessful. Jesus regarded that the essential part of human nature is spirit. And whenever there comes the necessity for conflict between the need of the material and the need of the spiritual, the physical give way to spiritual, which is the most essential part of human existence. In the second temptation, Jesus in imagination stood upon a mountain from which the whole civilized world could be seen. This is called the pride of life. Prove it. Show us that you can fly. This is a temptation to compromise. The devil said, "I have got people in my grip." Just compromise a little with the devil and people will follow you. It is a constant temptation to seek to win people by compromising with the standards of the world. It is a lesson to the Christian that each of us must be consumed by the conviction of the infinite beauty of holiness and the infinite damnability of sin. In the third temptation, Jesus in imagination saw himself in the pinnacle of the temple, where Solomon's porch and the royal porch met. This temptation is concerning the lust of the eye. Beauty and power of the earth's kingdom. This was the temptation to give the people sensations. Jesus said, no, you must not make senseless experiments with the power of God. Jesus saw very clearly that if he produced sensation, he could be only a 9 days wonder. He also knew that sensation do not last. I would want us to note that the Lord quoted the written word to defeat the devil. We must learn the word of God to disapprove Satan of the many lies he brings in our ears. Of the time Jesus spent on earth, 30 out of 33 years was spent in preparation. Almost 80%. Thorough preparation is the secret of success in every struggle that we may have in this life. Thank you for watching this episode on the study of the life and ministry of Christ. Join me next time as we look at the study of the life and ministry of Christ, period 2.